Inferior is finally and permanently discredited and abandoned. Everywhere is war. It's a war that until they're no longer first class and second class citizens of any nation. Until the color of a man's skin is of no more significance than the color of his thighs. It's a war that until the basic human rights are equally guaranteed to all without regard to race. And it's a war that until that day, the dream of lasting peace, world citizenship, rule of international morality, the remaining but a fleeting illusion to be pursued, but never again. Now everywhere is war. War. And until the ignorant and unhappy team that hold our brothers in Angola, there must be South Africa, subhuman bondage have been toppled, totally destroyed. Well, everywhere is war.
Hello, good evening. Today, Wednesday, about 6, what time is it? 6:10 p.m. The sun is still shining out here. It's not dark as yet. I'm doing a live broadcast because I'm angry. I'm angry about a lot of things. And you know, I'm coming at right now. It's a sea bridge. 100% the sea bridge. They were warned. Do not use those boats for the open waters. Those boats are nothing more than vomit comets. I've seen so many stories on Facebook and so many inboxes I'm getting from people who parents or relatives who went on those boats, those water taxis, to come to Tobago. And what happened, and some of them were disoriented, because they're not designed for open water. The hull shape is different. They don't have the stabilizers for the open ocean. The Gulf of Paria is very calm because, you know, at the closest point, you have the Venezuela right there, 7 miles, and it's close by, so it's sheltered. So it's a nice, smooth sailing from Port of Spain to San Fernando. But when you take that miles going out to the Bocas, there's no way. Good evening, Vidya. Good evening, Heather. There's no, and Lisa, right? There's, and Shelly-Ann. There's no way it can handle that. And they were warned over and over and over and over again. And still, because the Prime Minister think that it's okay, you could throw them scraps, and that's fine. That's okay, because you know what? It's Tobago people, man. It's my people. Yeah, right. And I'm not your people. So you could tell Rowley that I'm not your people. I'm not a sellout. And I'm not one of those kind of people who feel that hate themselves. I'm not one of that. So I'm not one of these people. So you can take that crap and go to hell with that. How could you? You have created this crisis. He has created this crisis. And I'm imploring Trinidadians, like it is, be careful taking those water taxis going across to Tobago. It was not sabotage. It was not sabotage. Those engines are running hot. They have to run hot. I've done a lot of bit of diesel engineering and marine engineering. I know what I'm talking about. So anything will go wrong because they're going under full throttle because they don't overcome the resistance of the waves. And this is what's happening right now. So you will take that water taxi, the vomit coming, and carry it all the way across to Tobago through the Bocas. Coming down should be easier because you're going with your current. But when you cross the Atlantic Ocean going across, that's where the issue lies. So coming back now, they said it wasn't sabotage. They said it was an oil line that went on from the turbocharger and went onto the exhaust, and that started the fire, which is believable, which is believable. I can see that. I can really see that. So that makes sense, but that shows poor maintenance too on that part too. That's what it's showing. Then at the same time, so the fire started and everything like that, and then they're telling everyone, keep calm, we're gonna take you from here and bring across to the Cabo Star. Because the Cabo Star was full send the scene. Why wasn't the Coast Guard full send the scene? Have you ever asked that? Why wasn't the Coast Guard full send the scene? Not the Cabo Star should be on the scene, the Coast Guard is supposed to be on the scene. Why is it that they were not on the scene until afterwards? That means they're not patrolling. That means they're not doing anything. All they're doing is games. So your taxpayers' money was spent for these fools to go patrol to protect our borders, and instead they're somewhere else or built somewhere. So the Cabo Star had to come in and rescue them. This is the most stupidest thing I've ever seen. Dereliction of duty. What the hell do you have a Coast Guard for? If they're not there, and they knew the risk was involved. So why do you have a Coast Guard go shadow them? But no, well, nah. It's Tobago people. Who the hell cares? It's Tobago people. Nah. They don't take anything. But what he said it himself. He said when he got inaugurated the first time, what he said at the time, he didn't swear in Ayanna Webster Roy. And he said, oh, no big deal. No big deal. She's Tobago people. She could take it. That gave his kind of mindset from then. And then she got his mindset now. And then she's in a state of denial, or what you call in communication, cognitive dissonance. So it's like, I don't want to hear anything. Cover my ears, cover my eyes. I don't see anything. I don't want to hear anything. I'm telling you what it is. And everyone believing her and thinking that she's the one, she's right and everything like crap. People are hurting. And she is, and Shamfer is given the illusion that everything's A-okay. Just like Rowley is trying to give you the illusion that everything's A-okay and everything is not okay. And please, before anyone start about Rowley and then Kamala have her own crap going on right now. So we'll deal with that in a little bit. But going back to what happened, the sea bridge belongs to the people of Trinidad and Tobago. Yeah, you're right, Carlton. That's what happened. You're playing cards and having a fish boat and having a good time and ogling the woman down at the other marinas and everything like that. While they're doing that, Tobago only have one blasted marina. Not even one blasted marina. So when all those yachts come into Tobago, whenever they can come, whenever they feel like, because immigration is not there anyhow, right? They dump all the crap out in the ocean. And we have no marina to take all that bilge and take that sewer and get it processed and charge them for it and create jobs and create employment and create revenue. Nope, we don't have that. But the Coast Guard can hang around and have a good time, right? Secondly, I heard someone in Boxman told me, I'm not too sure, but I heard that they didn't have enough life vests. The life vest was for like 50 people, and that boat is ready to carry 200 people. So for you Trinidadians coming from Port of Spain to San Fernando and back, you guys better watch out, because something happened then, right? You may not have enough life vests to save everyone. Watch out for that. That's what I heard. That's what the guy told me. I'm going to confirm that. So this is what happened. And then when they're transferring passengers from one boat to the next, you're supposed to have a lifeline coming across. That's how it's done. I've been on boarding a lot. A lifeline coming across, either a sling, you have a sling or a harness to move you from one place to the next. Because suppose you have women people who are in wheelchairs, who are incapacitated, who are on a wheelchair. How are you gonna carry them across from one place to the next? Anyone ever thought about that? Suppose you have mothers there who are 3-month-old babies, because the gap in between, from what I guess estimated out of a software, I can guesstimate now, was moving between 12 inches to 16 to 18 inches. The gap between the boats will just keep shifting like this. If a mother had a 3-month baby, that baby will fall right between them when they're trying to transfer. Was the most stupidest thing. So what kind of safety management we have? And you're supposed to have safety officers involved, and you're supposed to be ready for those kind of contingencies. What happened? No lifeline, no safety harness, no sling, nothing like that. We have nothing to say, well, to shuttle the passengers from one end to the next. And people say, well, we're normally supposed to have a ramp, but I mean, it's kind of difficult. I understand that. And I give them a little blind for that. But normally, in lieu of that, you have a sling to shuttle them across from one ship to the next, not just grabbing someone and carrying across. Because if I slip, because you're still at the ocean spray on the ground, and if I slip, someone fall right in between. And if you understand about marine propulsion, especially about those propellers, what it does, it creates a current. And once you drop there, it'll suck you right into the propellers. This is ridiculous. Stupid. And it goes on and on and on and on and on and on. And people are getting angry, and people are getting mad, and I like that. Let them get mad. Because this has been preaching over and over and over again. Stop. I'm talking to Trinbagonians now. Stop with the stoicness. I came from that culture, and I understand the whole culture, and I understand the idea that, you know, when you grow up in Trinbago, you're supposed to keep quiet and everything like that, and keep your head down and do what you're going to do, and don't tell anyone, and zip it up and everything like that. But I'm one of you who don't zip. I can't zip. I'm getting angrier and angrier, and I'm telling them, wake up. Stop the crap. Put a spoke in their wheel. Let them know you're not going to put up with it anymore. Because the more you keep on doing this over and over, the more you allow them to do this, they'll keep on doing it and they'll keep on pushing you. It's like bullies. Bullies do that all the time. They keep pushing you because you're not standing up to them. And if they stand up to them, everything changes. Maybe they may still bully you, but now they watch themselves now and be careful how they're going to bully you. You have got to stand up. You have two legs. Stand up. And even if you don't even need to do have two legs, you have a mouth. Stand up and tell them under no circumstances you're going to allow that bombing comet to come to Trinbago. It's horrible. I know people want to come to Trinbago for the Easter and everything like that. Don't get me wrong, because I'm trying to come to, and I'm having a hard time getting a flight to come because what happens? Caribbean Airlines don't have any code sharing with any other airline to book a flight from Trinidad to Tobago to Caribbean Airlines. It's an exclusive domain, just like the Sea Bridge. And then what happened now, we have Warren Sinanan now sitting in the back, and he's like, well, it's just a small thing. Yeah, it's a small thing. You could say it's a small thing because it's not your family. So you could say that. It's a small thing. That's all you could say. Say it as long as you want. It's not your family. That's why you're saying it. It doesn't matter because it seems like you're profiting from all this anyhow. So why should you care? It's a small thing. No big deal. In the middle of the ocean, there's a fire. You know what a diesel fire is? Does he have an idea of how a diesel fire works? And how bad it could be? Diesel burns at a hotter temperature than gasoline. And diesel will burn anything in its path. And he talked about it's no small thing. Because he created a crisis. Starting from all the way back with Fitzgerald Hines, start with him, that idiot, that fool. And all the PNM mites, you could quote me on that. He's a fool. Starting all the way back to 2016 when he promised we're going to have a boat. From April 2016, in 18 months, he promised we were going to have a boat. Then they said, you know what? Look at this fool. So they get rid of him and they put in Warren Sinanan. And Warren Sinanan have his own agenda. And he came in there and he started this nonsense. He started it. And they planned it out. And I can see clearly what's happening right now. And Trinbago is part of Trinidad and Tobago. And they have shoved this down all of us. They have shoved it down on the Trinbagoans, and they shoved it down on the Trinidadians, and they shoved it down on the Indo-Trinidadians, and shoved it down on the Black Trinidadians, and everybody, right? In order, they use an old British playbook. In order for you to control them, they divide them. That's how they do it. So now, I'm growing up, and I don't know what it's like. I don't know. I have limited contact with anyone from Trinidad, so I don't have. I'm trying to understand the whole culture and what the whole thing's about. But I don't. But because I'm away from it, I'm not immersed in it. I'm just supposed to be one country, two islands, but one country. I still don't understand it. Trinidadians come across to Tobago, and they still don't understand the psyche because of the fact that we were taught, all of us were taught, to hold our own corner and don't really know about everyone except superficially. And that's what happens. So that's how they control us. So you pick a side, you're on this side. You pick a side, you're on this side. And that's how you control all of us and everything like that. And then they start, and then by doing that now, then you can study all in the windows and everything like that, calling people of Indo descent the C word, and the people of African descent the N word, and everything like that. And everyone call each other this kind of name back and forth. And these two cultures are so creative and have created so much to create this country. And instead of us using these two cultures and combine them and use them and use their strength and resources for what they are, what we do is to keep everybody separate and take their energy and circle the energy back onto themselves. And by doing that, the country stays at one space. Because we can never see each other as equal. Never see each other as equal. And that's how they create it. That's how they create chaos. And that's how they keep the country at a standstill. Because I can't, because they don't want to harness the creative energies from someone who's in Kawani or from San Fernando or Bapaw. And they don't want to take the creative energy of someone who's been in Lavantil and beat them, but they got a stigma and everything like that. And they don't want to take the creative energy from today, because look at them. They look like sheep and they're dumb. That's what they think, right? And that's what it is. So we start that whole thing, and I don't like you because the way how you look and everything like that. And so it starts. And I blame Eric Williams for the whole damn thing from the beginning. Like I said, father of the nation, no. Father of his own spoils. That's what he was. And if you don't like it, too bad. But history has shown it. He started from the beginning. He started from the beginning with O'Halloran and all the corruption that was going on. And he never stopped it. And when I told you about the hero Gene Miles and what happened to Gene Miles when in the gas station racket and how they brought it down to nothing. Beautiful woman, and they boiled down to nothing until she became a drunk. They caused it. They caused all that to happen, and everybody took it like it's no big deal. I mean, come on. That's how they play the games. Like I said, it's an old British playbook. The British did it in Africa. They did it in India. Africa did a lot. One tribe. You put one tribe where you think is the dominant tribe. There's the idea, each one teach 100. So you have one educated person, and they send them to Cambridge or Oxford, educate them. They come back, and now they're molded in the British way of life and everything. So they come back and teach the other 100. This is how you're supposed to be, and slowly indoctrinate them. And that's how it is. India, they did the same thing, because Pakistan was part of India. And they use the Raj on one end, and they use the people who believe in Hindu nationalism on one end. And that's how the whole thing started. That's how Pakistan divided from India, and then Sri Lanka, and then Bangladesh, and all these other places, right? Games, same old British playbook. They use it back. That's the idea. It's nothing more than psychological warfare, which we are paying for the price to this day. That's what you're paying for right now. So now, look, so we're in a space, Trinidad and Tobago, we're on this rock. I mean, it is what it is, or birthright. And we supposed to hold our birthright, take advantage of our birthright, wrest our birthright from the powers that be, and project this country forward. But we're not doing it because we fight among ourselves. And the sea bridge is classic action, what they would do. So that's what they did. So they went, so he started with Ansonan, started with him, and the other company, I think something Jet. What Jet? I can't know what the name of the company. The company was giving them a very good offer to run the sea bridge. Plus, they was going to buy 20 defunct boats as part of the deal. And this is what happened. And you know what? They rejected them. And Ron Sinan had used his private email based on some Hong Kong paint company, something like that, which I'm not too sure if that was declared to the Integrity Commission. That's to show you on the level of deceit. Instead of using official email, use a Hong Kong email. And they said it. That's how they were communicating with him. And he's a transportation minister. And when you look at the whole thing in detail and you see the games, what he has been doing. So now with the sea bridge crisis now, this sea bridge has created over $1 billion in costs and losses. That's what it caused. Over $1 billion. For $150 million, we could have gotten a roll-off boat to suit our needs to hold 600 people and to hold at least 300 cars and about 150 in cargo. Multiply 150 by 6.6. I don't have a calculator in front of me here and everything. I never get to get my calculator. Well, forget it. But less than $1 billion, I can show you that. And we own the boat outright. Or they could have done a lease system and or put a bond for it, for the boat. But no, nobody still don't know who owns the Cabo Star. We still don't know that, right? Still don't know that. The same people who own the Ocean Flower too. That's how they're doing it. So now the investigation has stopped now because the Cabo Star, they have now become the knights in rescue right now. So everyone's so glad to have it. That's how they do it. That's how they do it. They play the games with you. And Tobago nuns better wake up. And I'm telling them like it is. You can't have everybody fight your battles for you. You have to fight your own battles too. You got to stand up and tell them, we're not taking it and I'm putting it out. And I understand what's going on in Tobago at the THA, because the THA employs 76% of the working population, plus the trickle-down effect of other people who depend on the THA workers to provide services and everything else. So actually, in a sense, I'd say close to 90% of the population is directly needs the THA for employment and for work and for wages. So they can't talk because the victimization is real. And when I tell a lot of Trinidadians about it, to them it's like they can't kind of like think it out. To them it's like, no, this is not right. This is not true. How could this happen? But it's really true. And Tobago is a small space. So what happened is that they go, so if you speak out, they know who it is who spoke out, and they'll go and they'll target you. That's how they do it. So you go to work next day and say, oh, you have no contract. I heard that you went on Facebook and said la 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 and everything. Well, guess what? By the way, since I no contract, you can go home, you can go home. We'll get back to you. And that's how the game is played. So people are scared. People are really, really, really scared of losing their work because since the money is circulating, right? They're scared that if they lose their work, what other employment they can find? Because they have destroyed the private sector. And I saw it coming about 10 years ago. And I warned people and I told them over and over again. And if you go on my Facebook, I don't care if you want to go, it's open. I have nothing to hide. And go back 10 years, they say I was warning them over and over again. Do not destroy the private sector. Do not do it. But under London, since he was getting all this money coming from Trinidad as part of the agreement with the Tobago Assembly. So what they were doing, they were creating jobs for nothing. That's what they were doing, creating jobs. So now people have their hotels or small hotels, and rather than mom and pop breakfast or small hotels, small inns, they'll say, you know what? Why you work for that little bit of money? And I can give you 10 days and you can work for 3 hours and make the same amount of money and even more. So you know what people did? People left. People left. People left the hotels and the quality went down because they couldn't find people to make up the beds. They couldn't find people to do the laundry. They couldn't find people to clean the place around because the THA was sucking them like a huge vacuum. And the idea behind the 10 days and all these make work scheme was for people who didn't have a job. They had a job. Yes, maybe it wasn't the greatest, but they had a job. And if they had a job in the private sector, then they keep on learning how to start their own business because people open up business left, right, and center. So in Tobago, what happened, because in Tobago, the carnival culture is not really our culture, and that's the honest truth. So what happened, like, they will save their money. Everybody will save their money bit by bit by bit, because in today's culture, land is the most important thing for us, land, more than anything else. So carnival ain't so great because of that. So we save money for the piece of land or open up business. And when we open up business, that's our independence. So what happened was that what the PNM did is that they start sucking workers, because what it did, it created a voter base. And that was the intent behind it, to create the voter base. When the PNM was in opposition in Trinidad, who you think was supporting the PNM opposition in Trinidad in terms of money? Was it Tobago PNM was doing it? Because they were in charge on the local government and THA. That is why over $1 billion is missing for 20 years. Over nearly 20 years, $1 billion is missing. And some of it, and I can tell you firsthand, some of it was siphoned to the people in Trinidad to support the party while there's an opposition. That's what they were doing. And kickbacks and schemes from left, right, and center, and everything like that. In one audit, I can't remember what year it was, I think 2012 or 2011, I can't remember. They had $21 million of missing money, where the auditor general said, I can't find this money. I don't know where this money is. On another occasion, they went, and while they're looking through the accounts, he found $5 million of money that was not declared. He found it in a bank, in an obscure bank account somewhere, that they never declared it. That's what they're doing. So that's what they'll do. So they both of them feed off each other. That's what happened. So what happened was that Cameron had screwed up because 2.5 years before, you had two people in opposition who were representing Tobago. Two of them. And when all the fiasco with all the scheming and the fraud and the corruption was going on and everything like that, people turned against them. And that was the real deal. And that's why the PNM came into power 2.5 years ago on the national politics in Tobago for the two representatives. Shaka wasn't there prior to that. She was a nobody. But because she could give the speech band talk, and because she sounded like fierce like Rowley, they put her as Minister of Tourism, which I can't figure out what's her qualification, because all she wants to do is to try to look good for some reason and try to make up herself and do nothing about tourism. Nothing. Lots of games. And our website, right? Same crap. Before that, never knew anything about her. Nothing. And now we have this representation that's going on right now. This is the kind of horrible representation we have. This is what we have. So when they start to understand the games and the machine and what's going on behind on the political machine, then they start to understand what's going on. And people are saying, well, okay, Tobago people, hold on 1 second, drink some water. It's not rum, it's water. Anyhow, so people are saying, okay, so why can't you guys start up industries in Tobago like how we do in Trinidad? They don't want that. They do not want that. I'm telling you, they don't want it. What they'll do, they'll give the money to friends and family, close friends and family. There's a few families that's running a lot of stuff in Tobago right now, and they give it to their friends and their family, and nothing gets done. And that's deliberate. And they will harass you if you have a business, and if you're a threat to them, you'll harass you to close down. That's how they do it. At the same time, the people in the Downtown Merchants Association, a lot of them, who are backers of the PNM, had always told the PNM, we do not want to be able to have an international port because of the fact of the historical linkage between people going from Tobago to Trinidad, to Port of Spain. And a lot of the income, a lot of money spent from Tobagoans to the merchants in Port of Spain. And those merchants in Port of Spain are PNM supporters. And they are the big party funders. And they will say, you know what? No international ports, because if we do an international port, what will happen is that we'll collapse, because people from Tobago will not come straight to Port of Spain to go ship with us anymore. So that's why Tobago don't have an international port. And that's why we're suffering too, because if we have an international port, then we could bypass what's going on and import everything straight from where it is. And then save, and then 50% of that cost we can save. But now you import stuff to Trinidad, get a whole Trinidad distributor. From there, we're gonna pay again to bring across to Tobago. And we're supposed to be one country. One country. And we have to bear that excessive burden and baggage. If I'm a UE student, I'm gonna take the boat to go to UE, or I'm gonna take the plane to go to UE for my exams. People in Trinidad don't understand how it is that you could go from Port of Spain to St. Augustine, no big deal. You're from the south, my girl is you, but you can still go. In Tobago, I rely on the boat not to reach in time for my exams or for my studies, and then go back. So because, I mean, I have to pay additional rent to stay there, which is okay, it is what it is. But at the same time, the transportation cost, additional transportation cost, is an undue burden that we have to pay. And people not seeing that. A lot of them, they don't understand with the whole concept. We don't have a planner, town country planner in Tobago. They have to come from Trinidad, and they haven't been there for months. So if I have to put up a house and there's an appeal, I have to file it properly, I have to go to Trinidad for that. If I have to register my land, I have to go to Trinidad for that. If it is an issue, medical emergency, I have to go to Trinidad for that. If there's something that's critically needed, I have to go to Trinidad for that. So when you start to understand that whole dependency structure that they have created, that the PNM have created over the years, because they refuse to put an international port and they refuse to do a proper decentralization, they don't want that. Because if you do that, they dilute the votes. That's what the real deal is. And I've been going on and on and on and on, and the finances are coming in right now, and slowly people are selling up. People are under stress and they are selling out because there's nowhere for them to go. People are unemployed, a lot of unemployed, and now because you have at the local level, you have almost 16 to 17 years. That's one generation at the local level has been under the PNM, so they don't know better. So the culture has changed from entrepreneurship to dependency. So all the younger people, that's all they know. The older generation know what the deal is, what the deal was, and how they are, and how they screwed the economy. Going all the way back in the 1970s. And I'm going to tell you all in a place what happened. Rowley went, he lost the election. Rowley has never held a seat in Tobago. Listen again. Rowley has never held a seat in Tobago. He has never held a seat in Tobago. Never, ever, ever, ever. Rowley lost the seat to A&R Robinson. But that's after the fact. Before the fact, they lost the seat. The PM had lost their seat to A&R Robinson. Another election. And Eric Williams said, let them eat grass. That's Eric Williams' term. I ain't no doctor, nothing. They're all doctors. Rowley a doctor, Eric Williams a doctor. Screw that. Eric Williams. He said, let them eat grass. We are so freaking mad at us for turning them down. Let them eat grass. And guess what happened? We ate grass for 1 year. My mother was a postmistress because my father died. So my mother took a job. My mother was a postmistress for Roxborough Post Office. And let me tell you what happened. For 1 year, my mother didn't have a salary. For one flipping year. And that's a damn truth. And I don't care. Anyone want to come to rock me? Tell me in my face. For 1 year, what Eric Williams did, he dismantled the Ministry of Tobago Affairs. And he split families up. People don't know this. He split the families up. So if you're working at the time for the Ministry of Tobago Affairs, you have to leave Tobago now and go live in Trinidad in order to keep your job. That's what happened. And for 1 year, the other ministries in Tobago, that's under the county council system, nobody got paid for a year. No one. People were bartering for this, for food, for this, for that, because money was not circulating. And luckily for Tobago, back going back to the 50s, because the abuse was going all the way back anyhow. So we had a system called Lenhan. And Lenhan system was where we will barter and trade goods or services. So if I'm a mason, I'll build your house in exchange for building your house. You're a carpenter, you're gonna do the carpentry in my house. And it's a kind of a rough kind of equal. So you buy for food, barter for, and everybody had a yard at the time, you know, little yard, bananas, whatever. So you barter for that. That's how a lot of people survive. And also who had relatives in Trinidad, because there are more Tobagoans in Trinidad than in Tobago itself. So a lot of them would send money across for the relatives in Tobago, especially their parents or their grandparents or their children. That's what they did. And that kind of like kept it buoyant. But El Quilas was a wicked son of a bitch. That's what he was. And that's what he did. And anybody want to call him father of the nation? My ass. He ain't no father of no damn nation. Okay, no more, and I'm done. I'm not too say anymore. Because they ain't gonna like me. He ain't no father of no nation. He was a father of oppression. Not father of the nation, father of oppression. That's what he was. And that's what he did. And at that time, I told myself, I will never, ever vote for the PNM Plantation National Movement, because they created a plantation. That's what they did. And that's why the Tobagoans had denied them and ignored them for all those years. Why do you think the Tobago House of Assembly came into being? The Tobago House of Assembly came into being because of neglect. Because they neglected Tobago. And they pushed them and they pressured them under A.N.I. Robinson to create the Tobago House of Assembly to stop the neglect. And the John Prince report said Tobago gets 4.6% or something like that to 8% of the national budget. But at the same time, going back to all the way back when Tobago became a water Trinidad, going back to independence, Tobago was always neglected. From independence going forward, was still neglected. Because Eric Williams said at the time when he was vying for independence of Trinidad, Tobago, he said, Tobago has replaced British imperialism for Trinidad imperialism. He said it. I didn't say it. He said it. And he did the same damn thing, the same damn playbook. And he played out. One after the next. So now, a lot of Tobagoans now feel that they're not part of Trinidad and Tobago. So in order for them to feel that way, they have to assert themselves and say, we're not, I'm a Tobago, and stuff like that, because of the fact they never felt they were part of the country of Trinidad and Tobago. They never felt that they felt like second class citizens. And I understand a lot of people also of Indo descent, how they feel about being in Trinidad too, because some of them feel that they're not part of them, because he created the atmosphere for that. The divide and conquer stuff. That's what he did. Look at the military, look at the police service. There are more Tobagoans disproportionately in the defense force and the police service than it should be based on the population. Why? Because what happened is that in order for people to advance themselves, they either join the military, join the fire service, join the police service, or enter any military organization in order to get out of there. That's what the real deal was. And they continued, and Tobago rejected them all the way until 2000, when Ho Choi Charles was in charge. Was part of the DAC, and he screwed up because he decided to come too arrogant and did a whole bunch of foolishness. That's how the PNM came back into power. And I said, okay, you know what? So now you have a younger generation who don't understand what happened before, because all of them died out. And I said, well, let's give them a chance, because they never grew up when the PNM used to victimize them hard from Trinidad. They didn't grow up in that era, so they were young. And I said, okay, let's give the PNM a chance. And then when the PNM came to power initially, what they did, they start using the money to buy votes and to expand their voter base. So back in the 1990s, when there was a lot of hotel industry and a lot of tourism, there was a lot of stuff going on. And they said, well, that can't be, because if you're independent and you think independent, you're going to run up against us because of the fact that you could think you don't need them. You don't need the government. And you could tell them like it is. So you know what? Go away. So what they did, a lot of these hotels, they started getting workers. Hey, you know what? You work 10 days, 10 days. You make more money in one day than you working 8 hours, putting people bed sheets and fixing everyone bed sheets and everything that. And they started sucking them away. And then the private sector was saying, stop doing it, stop doing it. Well, you're not giving them enough wages. You're not giving them this, you're not giving that. We give it to them and everything like that and so on. So the over-London theory of economic diversification is hire more people and give them stupid titles. So they start hiring more people because they had the money and they were given to them because, and then they hire more people and get more people because the idea was if the bigger go with the PM, then they stay in power. And when they stay in power, what happens was that they'll keep on feeding them the money and hire more people. And that's how it started. So people used to walk off our jobs. They'll say, you know what? I don't need to come here. What I need to go and clean a blasting room for and everything for white people? Why I gotta do that for? I don't need to do that. Tomorrow I gotta go right to the THA and I'll get a job. And that's exactly what happened. And start going from there on. In the meantime, the Plantation National Movement under Orville London, all they did is superficial stuff. That's all they did. Superficial. Right? Clean, green, and serene, all that nice stuff, right? But they did nothing to develop the island. Nothing to really develop the island. I'm seeing money and budgets going back 2008 for the jetty at Cove. The jetty at Stanley Park. This money was budgeted out for $5 million for Cove, another $5 million for Stanley Park, another $5 million for Plymouth Jetty and everything like that. And that money was never spent. Because they wanted to create that dependency syndrome. And at the same time, the people in the DOMA, Downtown Merchant Association, those people who belong to that association said, to hell no, we're not going to have that to build up an international port. You're crazy. You want them to not stop shopping here? Because who's going to shop in Port of Spain with all the crime and everything like that? Who's going to have a shopping port of Spain with? Tell me. Now people from Central, because Central are the only economy going there right now. So who's going to do it? If you want to be able, when you get off the boat, it's easier access for them to go there. Because I'll admit, I used to do that too. I used to do that too also. But this was the name of the game. That's how they did it. That's how they did it. And they started. So when they started to understand how they started to build everything up, any mini mini more, that's how they started building it up. At the same time, the people in Central are not supposed to trust them, or from the South are not supposed to trust them because they look different from me and everything like that. And they keep it going. So they say, you know what, we hold our corner, you hold your corner, and that's how it is. So the two parties, that's what they keep doing over and over again, right? Playing one against the other and everything like that. And not knowing that the same damn finances they have on both parties. At the same time, the country is not prospering. You have more people who outside who are prospering of trying to be origin than people on the inside because they're suppressing you. That's what they do. They don't want you to rise. So when you have companies like Neil and Massey and Subway Industries or whatever it is, and they're buying all their business across the spectrum, watch out. That means they're controlling everything and nobody can come in and start a business. It'd be difficult for them. And the government's seen it, not stopping it. Our country is a corrupt country. And let's admit it. I have access to a lot of files on other things. I've had access to files here from some, let's say, associates, if you want to put it that way. I have satellite imagery of drug use going down in North Trinidad. I've satellite imagery of police vehicles escorting the drug dealers as they go down, as they go down from Chagaramas coming all the way down. Satellite imagery of that. I have the satellite imagery of where it took place. successful imagery of whales in the Atlantic, where it was exchanged, of all that. And the issue is they're getting the small fish. And the problem is the government, our government, allegedly, they know about it, but they're not doing anything about it because a lot of the people who are doing it are funding them. And that's what the real deal is. And that's why a lot of countries are not sharing their data with Trinidad and Tobago because they know they're corrupted. And don't let them disappear anymore, the UNC also. Kamala, when Kamala was in power, Kamala was the one who went and had a joyride with a drug dealer in Miami, Florida. He had a huge estate, I think an 800 acre estate in Florida. And she was there in his little RV, driving along and everything like that, driving along with him. And when he came back to Trinidad, he claimed that he would put $14 million for a window factory. Well, get, you know what happened to him? I'll tell you what happened to him. He got arrested by the DA about three years ago. Because they were on to him. So don't tell about UNC also, because UNC is same crap. And this is what is taking place. We're in a pinch and move. So you have one set of drug dealers on one end that supports the PNM, and every set of drug dealers on the other end that support UNC. And that's what's happening. Yeah, then she would have wrong. Check it out if you think I'm lying to you. Check the facts. She would have wrong in the RV with them, with a guy. And then she could put up a window factory and invest $14 million in the window factory in Central. I'm not too sure whatever happened to that. But he got arrested. He and his wife got arrested. So this is what happens. This is what they're doing over and over again. So both of them are playing each other, and they're playing us. They're playing us over and over and over again. Lavatil has one of the best real estate in Trinidad because the view is fantastic from Lavatil. Why do you think they want the place to stay like it is? It is unconscionable to have citizens of the so-called third richest country in the Western Hemisphere, and you have a place like Lavatil that exists to this day. That should never happen. People still using Latin in Lavatil. And then what happened now, you see, this, and going back to the same thing I'm talking about, the mindset. Because once you start getting the poverty mindset, after a while, they start accepting it. And when they accept the poverty mindset, then it becomes normal. So how they live, it becomes a normal thing. And then it's hard to change people's mindset on that, unless you go in and radically show them what their life could be. But when you have generations coming into it, when you have a generation coming in, who the gangster, well, for not everybody in Hamilton now, small minority. When you have a small minority who go in there, and the young boys are seeing all these young gangsters coming up there with gold chain and everything like that, and yeah, look at me now, I know, you know, I want this and everything like, here, look, you know what, you want some money, things starving? Yeah, look. Here's $300. It's yours, man. It's yours. Here's $500. It's yours. And then the drug dealer come back. Yo, you know what? Remember I give you all that money? You think, I didn't give it to you for free, no. I give it to you for a reason. So here's what. You owe me, but you're young. So what? I can't make a jail. So I have somebody to take out. I'll get a gun, take them out. But he won't tell them directly. He would tell another of his associates to get the gun and give it to them and to take out the person. And then they start renting the guns. And the police start renting the guns. And the cops, the police in Trinidad are onto the scene too, because a lot of them are renting their guns out. I went to the gun range with an instructor and a marine instructor. And he has a small contract to provide weaponry and training. I think like four or five years ago, to Trinidad and Tobago, not Defense Force, I think it was one elite army and police service. So we were talking about it, and he was fascinated by the fact that I was from Trinidad and Tobago, and he had his contract. So he was telling me that, you know what, what's really going on, because he didn't understand the whole thing, and I was explaining to him, and I said, listen, all these weapons that you're shipping to Trinidad, What they need to do is to, because what a lot of states do is that they keep, we shoot it, and we keep the casing and we keep the shells. So you have the rifling on the inside, so you match the rifling to a gun. And they keep it. And I said, bag it up, put it separately, and set it down there separately, and tie it into each gun. So any police rent a gun, and they use ballistic tracing, you can see where the gun came from. They rented a gun, and who it came from. I'm not too sure if that happened or not. I'm not too sure. But I remember I spoke to them about it, because I said, there's a lot of corruption going on inside here, and everything like that. And this is what we're going to have to do to protect yourself. But, you know, he said, yeah, you'll do it, but I'm not too sure we did it. But this is what they're doing. So everybody renting guns. So from Venezuela now, is are washing guns and no food. So when Chavez was in power, Chavez moved the weaponry from American weaponry to Russian weaponry. So now, they ain't got no food. There were a lot of M16s out lying all over the place in Venezuela. So fine, I'll give you an old M16. What are old M16 cost? Well, if I meet you out in the high seas, I'll give you 6 chickens, 20 loaf of bread, and believe it or not, tampons. Because tampons is hard to find, and tampons command a high price. And that's what they do in exchange for M16. And then by giving some initial bullets, and then afterwards they come in here and they got corrupted soldier, especially soldier, to get them the bullets. Not the gun, just the bullets. And that's how the game starts. And instead of us shutting down our border and seeing it for what it is, we are allowing it to happen. And last night was a perfect example. So the boat had stranded, and now look, the Coast Guard didn't even show up until afterwards. And you want to know, why is it our borders are so open? How the hell, where were they? We have 12 boats for the Trinbago Coast Guard. Jamaica has only 3 boats, and they're twice as big as we are, when you include Tobago. They're twice as big, and they have 3 boats, and we have 12 boats. And no Coast Guard was inside. None. Where were they patrolling? You tell me. And that's your tax dollars. Your tax dollars is involved in this. Your tax dollars. They're so corrupted. So, okay. Where were you? Where were you? Why are we still having this gun issue still? Why are we still having that? Why are we still importing guns and admitting that 40% of the containers are not being searched? No, I'm sorry. 40% of the containers are only being searched. The rest go on their merry way. Now you see, custom officers are coming in, are getting arrested for bringing contraband in, bringing money in, and everything like that. And people don't understand. When you see that money represents 1-4% of whatever illegal transaction I went down. When you're doing money laundering, is the going scale is 1-4%. Maybe if it's really risky, maybe down to 7%, up to 7%. But the average is 1-4%. So even if we were conservative and said, let's say 1%, and the custom guy got caught with $100,000 in US dollars, your better bottom dollar was nearly $10 million in drugs and contraband. Y'all need to listen to me and listen to me carefully. That's what's happening. So everybody's corrupted. The whole place is corrupted. And the government is not creating measures how to stop the corruption. If we can't bring anybody in here to help us stop the corruption, you can create systems to stop the corruption. There are a lot of ways to create systems. Hold on. One classic example. There was a unit that was totally, totally corrupted, but they couldn't get the evidence how they were. So what they did, they take 10 of those guys, put them in a room, and said, you know what? We're gonna have a special operation. We're gonna hit this drug dealer here, we're gonna hit this guy here, we're gonna hit this guy here, we're gonna hit that guy here. But first, we're gonna hit this guy first. and we're gonna hit him in 2 hours. All right, guys, that's it. So they had him out in the courtyard, and the corrupted cops, in the meantime, was calling the drug dealer and let him know. It wasn't a real raid. It was putting it out there, and was calling him and telling him, you know what? Hey, it's coming down in 2 hours. Go hide the shit. Well, guess what? The phones were tapped. Everything was tapped, and they knew which cop had called the drug dealer, and that's where they got him. And when they got him, they pressure him, and he squealed on the others. That's how you get things done. You start do that kind of subterfuge, and you see the difference. But right now, in Trinidad, they don't care. They don't care. So they rather the country go down into the abyss, and the people are nothing more than background noise. That's all you are. Nothing more than background noise. That's all you are. You ain't the greatest. You ain't the greatest. You're not gonna be the one to say, okay, you know what? They care about me. They don't care about you. If they cared about you, we'd have had a world-class healthcare system. That's what we'd have. Why on some forensic they still have to go to Barbados? That doesn't make any sense at all. I mean, come on, really? Without a world-class system, so Maxi Coffee, $13,000 a day, which is almost equal, $12,000 a day, US, which is almost equal daily rate for the super fast Galicia that kept a stable sea bridge. Can you figure that one out? 14.4 was the Galicia. Maxi Coffee is $12,000 a day. Which one benefit the country more? Meanwhile, you have young children who can't get anything, no funding or anything like that for their medical issues. But he got $12,000 a month. And he joined a minister's salary. Because they don't care about you. Why would they care about you for? As far as they're concerned, you are just cannon fodder. So what about the violence? We don't care about that. But that doesn't bother us because you know what? We behind gated communities. And besides, you have a diplomatic passport. We can leave anytime you want. Come up here, have a good time, relax. You know, invest in this business, invest in that business, invest in a condo in Miami and everything like that. That's no big deal. That's no big deal. That's fine. I don't have to live with it. I can jet up anytime I want. But meanwhile, the money laundering continues. The money laundering continues. You have all these Chinese. You have all the Chinese are coming in. Listen to this now. In China, you can't start a business in China unless you have a Chinese partner who is more than 51% in the business, and they have to take the lead. However, in our country, Trinidad and Tobago, you can, as a Chinese citizen, can come in with all the money and no one's asked where that money's coming from. And if it's the triads are giving them the money and the human trafficking that's involved and how much money they make off the gambling, and there's no system in place to see how much money they are making so they can tax for the gambling. You don't know that? You're just doing something arbitrary. But what they're doing, they're bringing all these slots. There's no gaming commission, real true gaming commission, which is supposed to go in and calibrate the games so they have the right fair chance of winning. You leave it all to the operator. And so who would want, they would love that. They love that. So they come in, set it up, so they give them a chance. Let's say the one-arm bandit, let's say it's 1 in 1,000. It's supposed to legally push out. They put the 1 in 10,000, 1 in 21,000. Doesn't matter. Who cares? And they control it. In the meantime, the government doesn't get the revenue from it because the gaming commission, there's nothing there. They don't control it. They're supposed to calibrate the system themselves and put an anti-tamper proof system in place so they can't mess with it. And go in and check the revenue and double check the revenue to make sure they're getting the right amount of revenue from these games. But nope. That's not happening. So what you have now, you have the, you come in there and make as much money as you want, however they want, whenever they want, and everything, and the government sits back and allow it. And that's bringing the trials in, it's bringing everybody could think of, everybody on the international field of gambling on the illegal side. They bring them in to Trinidad because Trinidad is like, you know, it's good, it's the greatest thing out because of the volume. In the Bahamas, when you have gaming, it's only set aside for the tourists and not for the citizens. And you listen to me well. Like the playway, like we have the playway, only the local people will do the playway. But for the regular heavy gaming, no citizen is allowed to go and do the gaming in the Bahamas. They are strict. They have a regulatory control over it because the idea is that if their currency, the Bahamian currency, is used in the gambling, it erodes the currency because now more and more the currency has to be converted to US dollars and then it gets shipped out. So it weakens the currency. So it's only tourists. Is a tourist attraction. Only tourists are allowed into the casinos to gamble. So it wouldn't erode their economy. So it wouldn't erode their currency and the value of their currency. But in Trinbago, is anything goes because everybody pay a bribe. So the Chinese woman, she can't speak English, but yet she has a gun permit. Go figure that one out. So they come in here and they reap and they make a lot of money and they take all this bag of money and then they go here and they put it in such a bank and say, you know what? We are converted into US dollars. And that put pressure on the currency because now the true value of currency just got eroded. But you didn't know that because you still think it's 66. But in the meantime, on the international market, they're seeing the play where the amount of foreign reserve has gone down by a certain amount, let's say 0.005%. And then the real true trading currency, true value of the currency has now been downgraded by that amount because you have less foreign currency. And the government is not doing anything about it. They sit back on it and they sit back and they allow it because you know what? They provide employment. Yeah, I understand that too. They provide employment. But the idea is that to do something like this, you have to have local people who are the majority partners in an adventure like this because if anything happens, you have the local people you can go after, not the Chinese, because the Chinese can leave anytime they want. And when they start to understand the whole concept of money and economics and the idea of how money is supposed to circulate, and then they have what's called velocity of circulation, right? When they start to understand that, you start to understand a lot more things. So the money is supposed to be circulated in the economy. So now instead of the government pushing towards small business, because small business, like I always say over and over again, is the engine of any free economy. Small business. You don't stifle small business. You encourage small business because they let the money circulate faster to the economy. But they're not doing that. What they're doing is stifling small business. So when these small business come and they want to get raw US dollars to bring in raw materials to convert the raw materials into a finished product, which pound for pound is worth 100 times more than the raw product, and then they get 100 times more, where they can go and sell outside and bring more US currency in and everything like that. They don't do that. They stifle them. So you have a small business, and let's say you're selling, let's say, pepper seasoning or seasoning. Let's say, for example, seasoning. You don't get the US cash that you need to import the machinery to make yourself more efficient. So therefore, your cost or your product goes down, and then you can make more money, so your profit margin is higher. And then when you sell it outside, what happens is that you make more foreign currency, Forex. And that money comes back and it circulates in the economy. And then therefore, it loosens up the stranglehold that they have on Forex, and more people have Forex. And then the currency gets relaxed. That means that the currency is strengthened. But they don't want that. And you know what? You want to know how much you know about this? When Savgar said that the country dollars need to be devalued. He said it, that the country dollar need to be devalued. It's only going to benefit him, because he's the one, his companies, his group of companies are sucking the Forex. And when they suck the Forex, what happens is that it undermines the currency. That's what's happening. So he wants that. He don't mind that because he collected a lot of Forex. So I don't understand how a new car dealer gets a significant amount of Forex, because that new car dealer is not generating foreign currency. They're not. They're using up foreign currency, but they're not generating foreign currency. So the other smaller businesses that are generating foreign currency, you starve them out. Not making sense. Haiti is the way how it is, because Haiti, due to embargo and other deliberate actions, and also because that dictator destroyed the middle class. When there's no buffer between the upper class and the middle class and the lower class, and there's a chasm in between, and there's a vacuum, it doesn't help the economy, because the people who are extremely rich have creative ways of avoiding taxes. The poor people don't pay taxes. So who's going to pay taxes to keep the infrastructure going? There's nobody. There's no one. There's only a small, tiny middle class, and they squeeze them even more. The middle class pays the most taxes. The small business pay the most taxes because they don't have the creative accountants to lower their taxable amount. And this dumb fool called Imsbert, don't understand economics. He's an engineer. He doesn't understand economics. And he doesn't understand why the hell are you going and taking that money and giving it to everyone. Charlie Elias was head of telephone company. What he did? He went and bought a Neil Massey company for $400 million. All the foolishness that goes on. Meanwhile, internet service sucks. It's garbage. You can't have a proper internet infrastructure, so now you could have more internet packs, and then people will create more software development, and then they could go more along that line and do data mining and everything, and create a whole new industry off of that. They don't understand that whole thing. So now you bought this stupid company that had semi-obsolete equipment and absorbing into TSTT. Now TSTT is picking up laying off because they have too much money, because they're bloated. Meanwhile, the internet service sucks, and no one is thinking of strengthening the internet service. In this new digital economy, you have to have a very strong and robust internet service, because that will create more industries. Let me give you an example. I'm involved in like cryptocurrency and all that nice stuff, cryptocurrency. And, you know, and what's called blockchain technology. I just do it for whatever. Anyhow, right now, because it's a new economy, it's a new type of digital economy. So it's like how the internet was back in the 90s. The internet was more about consumerism and more about social media and information. Blockchain technology is more about products and finances. So there's a value system attached to blockchain technology. I won't go into it. One night I'll explain everything to everyone. Anyhow, and a software developer who knows blockchain technology, average pay right now is $180,000 a year. $180,000 a year. More than the average software engineer. Because of new technology, but in order for you to harness that new technology, you have to have a strong internet system. And we don't have a strong internet system. Because we shouldn't be having issues where we are paying for this and paying for that, and we're having blocks and pieces and everything else. That doesn't help. It doesn't help in a new economy. It doesn't help at all. So we focus on that. Because if people are trying to be, especially Trinidad, they are extremely creative people. extremely creative. Why are we not pushing that? They're not pushing that because they don't care. That's what happened. So this is what they're doing right now. So now, what do we have? Let's see. Let's see what we have. Raw products. Oil prices went up right now because of what's going on in the Middle East. With Saudi Arabia and Yemen and all that garbage. So prices are going up. Natural gas prices has gone up, has stayed stable. We use the Brent crude model. And we supposed to have more money coming in. Now, what's happening is that our government lack of, I'm not sure what you want to call it, apathy or ignorance or don't care, however they care, however they don't care, doesn't matter, are not doing anything to push for the small business. What they're doing the same old playbook. And the playbook is, I am going to destroy the St. Augustine nursery so I can put up other apartment buildings. So now I have a voter block here, and that will make me get that seat. That's what they're doing. They're spending money on a repo savanna, rape it and destroy it, to put a road to nowhere and everything like that, so their finances will make money for them. That's what they're doing. And then when they come back to the Boca Reef, to the Boca Reef. Same thing. They want to put the Sanders inside here. So now, but Sanders is not creating the forex of Trinbago. All they're doing is wages. That's it, nothing else. Wages and allegedly the so-called hotel tax. But the government, what Sanders have been doing in other islands is that Sanders have been raping them. So what Sanders have been doing, and you can look it up, in Antigua, what they did in Antigua, and how they used their muscle to push Antigua in a corner and force them to make concessions. You can see how they did it, using the same playbook. That's why we're already like Sanders, because Sanders used the same playbook. So you create a large population of people and you give them 2,000 people, you give them minimum wage jobs. And then they're there, and when they protest, if you shut them down, you're messing with the economy. That's what they're doing, same crap. So that's what they did. They did with that. They did it with Antigua. Antigua pushed back against them. So what Sanders said, okay, you know what? I'm going to screw you over. So what Sanders did, they bought the Jamaica Observer. Jamaica Observer is owned by Sanders. And they start making attacks against the Antigua Prime Minister. Barbados, same thing. Grenada, too stupid to understand what's going on. And the other islands, same crap. That's the game they play. But that fits directly with Rowley because he likes that. He likes to destroy all natural resources because it's normal for him. It helps him. So now, you have the Boca Reef now. So now you have that area. So now you put up a huge monstrosity for 40 years and get some of that deal. And then some of the people in the Trinbago, not hotel association, yeah, some of them too, and some of them also in Trinbago, with the communists or whatever it is, right? What they want is Sanders, and they think that Sanders is gonna buy from them. Sanders is not gonna buy from you, and I'm telling all you people in Trinbago, especially the ones, the business people in Trinbago, Sanders is not going to buy from you. They're gonna buy from you initially to make you feel good. But they're not going to buy from you. They're going to bypass you. Because it's called economy of scale, meaning they're going to buy in bulk for all their places and they get a cheaper price. They're not going to buy from you. What you can provide for them? You can provide 2,000. You can provide 2,000 melons every single day. You can do that. Huh? Can you do about 10,000 kinds of sardines every day? No, you can't. So they bypass you. Yeah, thank you about the pitch league. We'll get to the pitch league. So they'll bypass you and ignore you and everything like that. And then what happens? What happens? You say, well, I thought they were going to buy from me. They ain't gonna buy from me. They don't want you. They don't care for you. The people on the retail side who work for Sanders, they buy stuff from you. But that's about it. But you don't get any big bulk order from Sandra, so forget it. At the same time, so you create this cluster of low-wage people working just to make ends meet and everything like that. And once you do that, bing, you got them where you want them. Now, they will vote for you whether you like it or not. Because if they don't vote for you and they think of not voting for you, all they're going to talk or call that sound and say, you know what, threaten them about their jobs. And they'll change their mind. That's how it is. It's games. All games. All games. Like the pitch lake. No one knows what's going on with the pitch lake. The pitch lake, largest pitch lake in the world. No one knows what's going on with the pitch lake. The pitch lake is there. It belongs to all of us. The people of Trinidad and Tobago. Yet, you have this plantation, all the plantation ministers not saying anything about the pitch lake. I mean, asking over again. And I tell you, it doesn't belong to them. Over and over again. They're just mere stewards. That pitch lake belongs to you. The book of reef belongs to you. All the natural resources belongs to you. Not to them. Stop seeing them as kings. Stop seeing them in this light as if they're the honorable one. Not honorable, the dishonorable. Stop seeing them like that. They go to the bathroom like you. They have pants. They wear pants or skirt just like you. They have underwear just like you. They're not tin gods. You hold your feet to the fire and you tell them enough is enough. I want to know where my pitch lake is. I want it because that belongs to me. The treasury belongs to me. That's my money. You know, when you go to the bank, you look at your bank book and you say, hey, you know what? Why is it I'm losing $4 here and $5 here? And you'll cross the high heaven because they want to know why you lost that money, $4 and $5. Why not cross the high heaven when they burn out $62 million, like what Kamala did with Cambridge Analytica? $62 million she took of your money to go spy on you. And the guy did it under oath at a British parliament. Facebook's stock is down right now because of this. $62 million to spy on you. And they created a profile of you. So they started a profile. I mean, I've done campaigns, but this one drills down to the most basic level. So what they did, they create a profile of you based on the pictures and everything like that, and what you post or whatever you post, and all your private calls and Messenger, they have a record of that, and who you speak to and everything like that. And they create this whole profile of how you are and what you are, and a propensity for violence, and a propensity to vote this way, and your outlook, and how you see life, and how you view life. And based on that, they drill it down and they target you. And say, you may go this way. So if you go this way, here's how we're going to target you. How do you think you're getting all these robo calls? Those robo calls, automatic robo calls. From Cambridge Analytica, get all that. And that's illegal. That was spying. The same Kamala, when Manning left and she came into power, had shut down that special operations. Because she said it was spying on her. And she ended up spying on everybody else. And y'all want to put her in power? Or you're mad? Don't give me that. I don't want to hear nothing. Those who want to vote along ethnic lines, that's your business. Take what you get. Take what you get. She spied on you. All your personal behavior, or everything. All the naked pictures. All the naked pictures. Everything you had. She spied on you. Your privacy. That's what she did. Spied everything on you and seen everything for what it is. Took everything, all your information, your private information that's supposed to be private. She did it. They used Cambridge Analytica, used Trinidad Tobago as a guinea pig. And after Trinidad Tobago, other countries start using Cambridge Analytica, including the Republicans, in the last party. That's what they did. And y'all allowed them to do this to you? And then you want to come and say, well, we're going yellow and steady. She bad too. She did it. And in the official comments, he's saying, yes, you know, we're Trinidad and Tobago, in this country called Trinidad and Tobago, where he's the former Minister of National Security, and he was deeply involved, and he told us what to do, and everything else, and it was all spanning you. She kicked out the SIA. She kicked them out, right, at the time that man had created, said you're spying on her and she was spying on you. And you all want to vote out, you want to vote that woman. You all are mad. All must be mad. It's like you all, like a lot of people lose their self-respect. You can't let people determine your future and your destiny. You can't let them make you lose your self-respect about yourself. You're human. You have your children to think about. You have your family to think about. You have your wife. You have a husband. You have a boyfriend, girlfriend, whatever. And everything like that to think about. If you don't want to think about yourself, think about your family and think about your future and think about their future. If you don't like yourself, that's okay too. That's up to you. You could think about that. You don't think about that, but think about your daughter, your sister, your cousins, your aunt, and all the younger people who need a better country. Not because you depressed about yourself, me, you're gonna stop fighting. You gotta keep on fighting. And that is why I don't trust both PNN and the UNC, the Plantation National Movement and the Dunks. And Dunks, D-U-N-C, Dunks. Both of them, all great games. And Turkish Ramadan name was got called out because he was involved in it. They were heavily involved in it. And that's what they did. Still got the data mining and everything like that. They couldn't do it here to like somewhat cross international because they couldn't do it cross international too much at the time because of the fact that they were violating some US federal laws and they couldn't do it. But the local people, which was a violation and a serious criminal offense in Trinbago, Kamala did it. She authorized and she did it. And then she's trying to come here, trying to be a damn saint. And say she don't know nothing about it. You did it. And I meant you did it. This is what happened. This is what they did. So both of them, same coin, same set of finances and everything like that. You ever go look up Trinbago and look up the CIA fact book about Trinbago? And they will tell you that the PNN, I mean, look it up. You can look up now on your phone if you want to. And they say the government party had a lot of been supported by a lot of the same drug dealers, was involved in the drug trade, and on the UNC side, but a lot of the drug dealers were involved in the drug trade also. And they both of them competing, and that's what you're saying. Go look it up if you think I'm lying to you. Look it up. So all these people who right now we're dealing with the PNN right now, red and ready, everybody red and ready, not knowing that these fools who supporting them, that party don't belong to you. It belongs to the 1%. That's what it belongs to. They control everything. Look it up. They put it there for you to see. They're there. They control it. You don't control nothing. You're just puppets. You're a pawn. You're a chess piece. Move me here, move you there. Make some noise, you know, you have a big mouth. Pay them till I'm dead. I'm dead, I went away till I'm dead. Yeah, move it here, you have a big mouth. Yeah, you good. That culture, everybody want to be a part of. Beautiful culture, you have Caribana. Eastern Parkway is the largest parade that they have in the United States. Eastern Parkway. Caribana, the largest one in Canada. All created by creative Trinidadians. And why we can't be that creative for our own selves and not seeing things for what they are, stand up and fight. Stokely Carmichael coined the phrase, Black is beautiful. You're from Trinidad, Black Power. You're from Trinidad. Ravi Rakbel, right? A guy, you know, they said, is fighting the Trump right now on immigration. Another Trinidadian. And I'm trying to tell you that this is what you all are so creative. Have that energy and have all that stuff going. And we're gonna take that energy and focus it and channel it and get rid of all these misleaders. We're allowing things to happen that way, you know. And this is what happened. And then you have on the other end, you have all these importers who are bringing all the food in and everything in the Trinbago and everything, and the food is expiring. Trinbago is even worse because after a while. The food is the shelf life is so low right now. So in Tobago, a lot of food are expiring and I throw it out. But you're not getting first class food, you're getting second rate food. I keep telling everybody over and over again. Men do not drink or ingest soy. I'm telling men this, don't drink and ingest soy. Soy is not good for men. Soy is a phytohormone, meaning it's a false hormone. So when you ingest it, especially if it has not been fermented right, and 90% of soy is GMO soy. So when you take, they use soy as fillers in a lot of food products, processed food products. So when you ingest soy as a man in your body, it converts, it fools the body into thinking it's a female hormone, estrogen. So it adds to everything, and what it does, it makes you get like male breasts. It means you get male breasts and shrinkage. Watch yourself. Watch yourself. Avoid that. Stop eating all these processed foods. A lot of them is not good. And not good for men. And that's why I see men having a lot of issues right now. And you women know about it. I mean, we're not go deep into it and, you know, get all into it. But you women know about it. A lot of men are having ED issues because of the type of food that they're importing inside of there, where they're using either the bovine estrogen, or they use a lot of soy as fillers, and that's what the soy does. So they put more and more estrogen inside of them, and then what happened now? All of a sudden, you see guys going breast. 20 years ago, 20, 30 years ago, men wasn't like that. I don't think I'm lying to you. Go look at photos of your father 20 and 30 years ago. Go look at him when he'd be back. Go look at him, and look at the guys now. You don't think I'm lying to you. Go look at any male relative who was bareback 20, 30 years ago and look at them now. And you see guys growing titties, right? Because of the soy and because of the estrogen that they're pumping in the food. That's why we need to go local and get local food and forget the processed food and stop making this 1% rich because they're getting second-rate food. These are the things we have to learn about appreciating our own food and our own food value. So we don't have to get pressure pills and diabetic pills and everything like that because we have diabetes is rampant. Because we have so much money allegedly circulating that instead of us going and do a home cooked meal, or even do a home cooked meal, I mean, make something simple, you know, out of mangoes, out of pawpaw and everything like that. Pawpaw is good for your stomach too. It's good for your stomach. And neutralize a lot of acids in your stomach. Pawpaw is good for you and also for the good gut bacteria. Pawpaw is good for you for that, right? Instead of eating that and everything like that, we're eating all the other garbage. KFC is not good for you neither. Stop eating KFC. I know it tastes good, but stop eating KFC because some of the ingredients is not good, right? And I used at one time, I think up to a year ago, I'm not too sure they still do the trend now, but up to a year ago here, they had used fire retardant on Subway meat. And they banned it. They stopped them from using it because somebody found out and protested about it. So I'm not too sure they're still using that fire retardant in the food for the Subways in Trinidad and Tobago. But we need to get a food lab to check it out because that is why our food lab needs to be working overtime. And our bureau standards will be checking all the stuff out to protect us because they join a salary too. Like the central bank, they join a salary too. That's what's happening. And nobody's doing anything about it because they don't care. It don't matter to them. It don't matter to them what it is. So you're paying all these people salaries to do all this job, and everybody going and posing nice BMW and Lexus and Mercedes Benz, and they're not doing their job to protect you. Yeah. And this is what happened. And everybody come and say, oh, well, you're right, Stephanie, right? Yep, you're right. You know, Obia, it's your food. Your food is messing them up. And Derek, yes, you're right. Time to vote them out. I agree with you, brother. I agree with you. 300%. I'm with you, Derek. You and I speak the same language. In fact, you and I are going to have to do a live together, you and I. 100%. Right? This is what they're doing. So they're screwed up with your food. And everything like that, we should produce sugar, not import sugar. Going back to the Moruga rice. The Moruga rice we have in Trinidad, that's a goal. That is goal. The idea behind the Moruga rice was that Moruga rice was a rice that came from Africa. During the War of 1812, when the British had invaded the United States and that burned Washington, D.C., some of the British, to encourage a lot of people on their side, had told the slaves who were there that they'd be free if they fought for the British. And when they had fought for the British sent some of them to Liberia and sent some of them to Trinidad. That's why you have first company, second company in Moruga. Now, what those people did is that they bought this rice. It's called, called a hill rice. And they bought the rice to Trinidad. In the meantime, that rice got wiped out in the United States. So there's none. No seed stock, no seed stock, nothing of that rice has been wiped out. And everyone thought that for the next 200 years, that disappeared off the face of the earth. Now they come to find out that actually Trinidad held the last remaining species of that hill rice. Now everybody making a big thing now. Now what's going to happen now, United States now, there's going to be a demand for that rice. Because for the first time they realize, oh wow, Trinidad actually has that now. Now they're going to go for it. Now what we should be doing is to patent it. Patent it and make money off the royalties off of that, because now we have the rice now. But it doesn't seem like they're really, really interested in doing that. And even though our patent office right now is the best for a lot of companies here in the United States to go patent stuff, Apple used Trinidad and Tobago. Apple used Trinidad and Tobago patent office to hide their patents from the Chinese and from the other competitors, because it had to penetrate Trinidad and Tobago patent office. So the Apple Watch was actually patented in Trinidad and Tobago. But because of the agreement of the Trinidad and Tobago patent office with United States, what patent is valid in Trinidad and Tobago is valid in the United States. So Apple did that. So Apple have been simply using Trinidad and Tobago patent office to bring a lot of products into the market. And now more and more companies are realizing that because Trinidad and Tobago patent office is not connected like the other patent office, where the Chinese can come in and hack them and steal the idea, they're coming to Trinidad and Tobago. Now we're supposed to be offering them, going to them and get their royalties off of them and make deals with them. But we're not that robust, and we're not thinking about that along that way, because we hate ourselves. And that insecurity is going to kill us. We've got to stop being insecure and start being bold. They don't understand the whole concept of what we need to do with the economy. Let's say we vote for APNM and a new party coming to power. When a new party coming to power and they say, oh, well, the treasury is dry. Big deal. So what? Big deal. There are 300 different ways I can show you how we can get something from nothing and start this economy, jumpstart this economy. And within 18 months, I can guarantee you, everything will be humming along and everybody will be okay. Everybody will be fine. And when we're having this misery and suffering that we are right now, just like the Tobago Sea Bridge. Now, what happened last night? It has affected the confidence of people who travel from Trinidad to Tobago for the Easter weekend. That's what it did. It affected the confidence. And that confidence kills the economy in Tobago. And people want to come to Tobago to enjoy the Easter weekend, to get it from Trinidad for a little while and everything like that. But that just killed the confidence. And instead of the government going to foot damage control, right? You have to answer them and say, oh, that's nothing, man. That's nothing. That's no big deal. That's no big deal, because it's not his family. They're going private jets. So when they go get his business in Hong Kong, he can go to Hong Kong and enjoy himself and everything like that. So we have to worry. We don't have to worry about going from Trinidad to Tobago and then come with his falsehood. But he cares. What do you care about? What do you care about? Yeah, Stephen, you're right. Right? Yeah, that's right about the rice. You're right. You know, I forgot about that. That's true. It's a hardy rice, and it's in terms of consistency, in terms of every single rice grain, it's more consistent. I make it easier to cook. That's right. I forgot about that. That's true. So yeah. So this is what happened, right? So this is what happened. That's why we have to go local and we have to change our dynamic and change the way how we think about ourselves. And stop letting this food decide for us. Stop living as if you're living on a plantation. You're not in a damp plantation. They want to give the illusion of you living on a plantation, and especially put you behind burglar bars because you have all these criminals coming here night and day, and they're not stopping. But it's not going to stop because they like that confusion, because they make money off of security services and everything like that. They make money off of that. They can expand the security services, and that's fine by them. And I said that once you're under pressure, you're looking for relief anyhow and anywhere and everything like that. So you'll go along with them. But we're going to stand after that. So we have to do a lot of thinking, a lot of generation thinking too, because our generation grew up under one particular party and mindset. And we have to move them away from that mindset to a mindset of empowerment. And that's the only way we can move forward. That's where the problem lies. That's our issue. And I know it's getting late for everyone. I know it's a long live. If you want to ask me questions, you can ask me questions now. And then I'll shut it off in 5 minutes and everything, and be done with it. And so on. Any comments, any questions, anything like that? No? Let me get some water in the meantime. I'm coming down. I'll be on the ground pretty soon. Once I get a flight, I'll be on the ground pretty soon. I'll be in Tobago and I'll be in Trinidad. And I'm going to still push the same agenda. And I'm going to challenge everyone to who are there. Well, let's go talk to each other. And we're going to find a way out to resolve everything. And see how we can push these fools who are in charge, because they don't have a clue. And as far as they're concerned, they are Lord. Dear Lord, and you are rock. So you must bow down and worship them. Not happening. Just like Trump here. Trump now is boxed in a corner. And all the people who were supporting him and everything like that, realize it for what it is. And now they're screaming the loudest, but it doesn't matter. What's gonna go down is gonna go down with him. But you see, in this system here, you have checks and balances. In Trinbago, our checks and balances are not working because everybody's involved in the corruption, greedy trade. And the only way you can stop this is for us to stand up. We have to stand up and don't allow these fools to come in and take things for what they are. We have to stand up on our own. We have to stand up. Just like how I'm seeing something right now, you can see something also about it. I didn't say we start no revolution or anything like that, but what I'm saying is that we have to stand up and make demands. I saw that they were marching against homosexuality or something like that in Trinidad, and that placard and that sign about that. Okay, whatever is whatever. At the same time, why you all march for your own personal freedom? Why you march for your own empowerment? You want to march over your religious belief and everything like that. Don't get me involved in that crap, because I'm not into that crap. Right? I'm about self-empowerment. Yeah, Lisa, you're right. Why we can't get all 41 ministers in our stadium and voice your opinion, let them know what you want. You're right. It's we the people. We the people. We got to make them uncomfortable. Make them all uncomfortable. They're making us uncomfortable every single day by their stupid policies. And do things behind closed doors and feel they can do things for allegedly for us when they're doing only for themselves. We need to go there and make their life uncomfortable. Track their every move. What are you doing? We are paying you a salary. What are you doing? What are you doing? Right? But we talk among each other, but we're not going to the parliament and demand better governance. Because all these 41 are nothing more than little monkeys. That's what they are. All they're doing is they talk among each other, but they're not talking to us. And then they'll come and have a meeting here and a meeting there, and who is there and who is that, and all kinds of things like that, and pose around and stuff like that. But they're not really talking to you because they don't care about you. All they want to do is say, you know what? I can't wait. My time to get into the treasury. I can't wait. I can't wait. Okay, you know what? The other person, that's good. Let them get all the jamming. We're only getting all the jamming now. Camera on the side, I say, well, I can't wait. Let me get my hands on the treasury, and this time I'll do it the right way.
and make it happen while I'd not be voted out again. She was snowball chance in hell. Ain't happening. Rory's going out. All the misleaders, they're going out. But we have to stand up and say we're not going to put up with the nonsense anymore. We want good governance. We want to be able to walk the streets without fear. And all those bandits and gangsters and everything that, yes, you'll provide a way because that's what we pay you for, to do your job. You'll do your job and you figure out a way how to get them off the street and put them in a program. And if you don't want to do the program, then fire up on them because you're coming down hard on them and you ain't playing around. Don't play around. That's what you do. You give them a safety outlet. Give them an outlet. Say, you know what? Here's what it is. We'll go into this program here and learn stuff and be constructive and be a constructive citizen. Or if you want to do the gangster stuff, well, guess what? This gun business is what is going to happen. You do a gun crime, right? There are special jail and a special court just for you because you're doing three times. And we're not going to make it nice for you. And ain't no frigging lawyer who come in there because all comes there's a lawyer society coming there, the lawyers coming there. And trying to get them off on technicalities and stuff like that. No, we threaten that crap too. So they can't get off. They're doing 3 years. A country could only get good governance if they support and strengthen and follow the laws with due diligence. If they don't do that, we're not going to get good governance. No more bribe taking, no more that. Like I told everybody, if I were to ever think of ever getting into governance, let's say I was voted in, I told the first thing first, my family are not going to get not even one contract for anything. Nothing. They may mean well, but I can't. Because I can't allow that to taint me. I can't allow the idea that, here's what, I have a relative who could provide the same service, but probably even better. But I can't have them. I can't have them going there and get the illusion that I supported them over just because I'm there. No, it is not what it is. So maybe I stay out of it. So let them make their money, and I don't have to get involved in all that. I tell them, well, no, you can't. You're bad from doing contracts. They just can't, because I don't want to get the illusion that I'm supporting you all and doing that and everything like that for them and the people that benefited. Is that right? So I guess we all get pauperized. I get pauperized too because then I lose money because I can't go and do. And behind the scene and go do other things. I don't want that. I love my integrity. I want to keep my integrity. My integrity was worth a lot to me. I want to go in the bush and go plant rice and go plant vegetables and go plant everything else and live life simple that destroy my integrity. It's not going to happen. I don't allow that. So, anyhow, no one have anything else? Okay. I don't say my piece. And peace to you all, and all the best. And I'll do another live. I might be traveling sometime next week. And so I might do a live sometime next week before I go where I have to go. Yeah, because where I go will be pretty far. So I won't be able to do anything. I'll be at silence. Anyhow, all the best. All the best. Keep your chin up. And remember, keep on loving yourself. There's only one of you, but there's two of me. Ha, I'm joking. There's only one of you, so love yourself and look in the mirror and realize, you know what? This human is a one-shot deal. Enjoy it and make it happen and keep on going for your empowerment. Have a nice night. Bye.